start. So it is my great pleasure to have Mary Czerwinski speaking today. And, you know, I could probably give an introduction that goes on for 20 minutes, but I don't want to cut too much into Mary's talk. So this is the abbreviated summary. So Mary got her PhD in cognitive psychology from someone named Richard Schifrin. And any of you that ever was in the field of psychology, this name would just light up with neon lights, because Richard Schifrin is really one of the most famous people in psychology. Mary had a very interesting career path. So she started off at Bellcore, which some of you may remember. Then she went to Johnson Space Center, then Compaq, and when she was at Compaq, Microsoft Research plucked her away, where she went on to become research manager of the Visualization and Interaction Research Group. So Mary is really a pioneer in the field of HCI. Mary has worked in fields of information visualization, visual attention, multitasking, emotion tracking, task management, and health and wellness. Mary's got so many accolades. I'm just going to name a few. She was awarded the ACM Lifetime Service Award. She was inducted into the Chi Academy, was an ACM Distinguished Scientist, and in 2016 became a Fellow of the ACM. She received the Distinguished Alumni Award from Indiana University's Brain and Psychological Sciences Department. So I've known Mary for a long time. We have collaborated quite a bit over the last 5 years. I've watched Mary mentor students. I've watched her as a manager. I've seen her as a colleague collaborating with people. And I've really learned a lot from Mary over these years. And one of the things I've always been struck by is Mary's generosity toward other people, in promoting young people's careers, in promoting her colleagues' work. And so she's really been a very generous person. So with that, I present Mary.
Thank you, everybody. Wow, after that introduction, now I really got to give a good talk. I'm going to be talking about some work we've been doing about the last 5 years. Actually, we started doing this work about the same time Gloria and I started collaborating real seriously together. And I could tell you some, I could tell a great talk about mistakes that I've made in this field over the last 5 years. I'll try to focus on the stuff where we've made progress. So I'll be talking a lot about effective computing today. And this kind of research cannot be done by yourself. No single person can do this. It takes machine learning people and database people and cloud people and mobile people and psychologists and designers. It just takes a crowd. So just know, I'm going to try to say everybody's names, but just know that it took a village to do a lot of this stuff. So how many people know what effective computing is? A few of you. Okay, we'll just go ahead and define it. It's actually the study and development of systems that can recognize, interpret, process, simulate, and I add, respond to human affect. And it was actually started in 1990 by Roz Picard. She actually wrote a book with the name Affective Computing. There were people who were dabbling in it before that, but she really kind of in the field of computer science got it started that year with her book. And she had actually been motivated by the idea of systems that could emulate sympathy or empathy for people. We actually were a little bit more motivated by something else. We were actually motivated to actually show you back your own signals for self-reflection. So that's what we were kind of starting from. And what do we mean by emotion? The technical definition, you can read it, there is actually physiological responses to stimulus in the environment. When we talk about emotion, it's usually kind of fleeting. It's not this long-lasting thing that maybe you would refer to as a mood or something. We're talking about something that's actually a response to a stimulus. And And here's the outline for my talk today. I kind of reorganized it last night. I'm going to talk a little bit about sensing, even though that's not my area of expertise. You have to cover it so people understand how we do it. I'm going to talk a little bit about my work with Gloria, although for 5 years there's just no way I could do it justice, so I'm just going to give you some examples from that work. And then I'm going to go into our actual work in affect detection and the kinds of applications we've designed. Then I'll talk about some recent work we're doing where we even get into mental health and signal emulation. And then finally I'll close with our more recent work where we've been working with the idea of conversational agents and affect. So the Cortana team has been wanting to work with me to kind of work on the idea of what would a personal assistant that could have affect be like, or detect your affect. So this was the old school way about 5 years ago when we were first doing this work. This was how we used to get your affect. We would recognize your affect. So we would throw everything at this problem. We'd put a camera on you so we could look at your corrugator muscles. We'd look at your mouth and your eyes. We would listen to your voice. We would look at the sweatiness of your skin, galvanic skin response, and now they call it EDA, electrodermal activity. We'd look at your GPS. We'd look at your heart rate variability, so you would always have a polar tick heart rate monitor on or some such thing. And when you put all those things together, listening to your voice, you put all those things together and you get really good affect recognition, right? But who wants to walk around with all these things? I mean, we've done a study where people had to wear a heart rate monitor for 2 weeks and people just were so annoyed by that. It chafes. If you're a little overweight, it hurts, it moves, you lose the signal. So it's kind of heavy duty, but when you can do all this, it's very accurate. Now, we've kind of moved to a system now where we do what we call sensor-free sensing or sensor-less sensing. And it turns out I had Javier one summer, he was an MIT Media Lab student, he showed that you even like bang on your keyboard harder when you're stressed. You actually hold your mouse with an extra digit when you're stressed, you hold it more tightly. We suspect that you probably swipe faster on your phone and your Surface Book when you're stressed out. So there's a lot you can do for free. You can even look at the activity on the laptop, on the phones, and determine some things like Gloria and I do. Now we've got Daniel McDuff in my group. That's Daniel right there. And he actually just uses cameras, and he can get your heart rate variability from a camera on your face, just from the different kinds of blood flow through your skin. So there's a lot we can do now that's kind of free, but we really like to use your voice, and we really like to use your face. It turns out leaning in, if you have a Kinect, is actually really, it's a good feature for machine learning models in terms of saying whether or not you're bored or interested in what's going on, but we don't usually do that. That's too heavyweight. And how do we get ground truth? So we use these self-report mechanisms. In computer science, the leading model is Russell's circumplex model from the 80s. It has two dimensions. On the x-axis, you have what's called arousal, and it goes from low to high. And on the y-axis, you have valence, which goes negative to positive, so sad to happy. So if you were super happy and exuberant, you'd be in this upper right-hand quadrant. If you were kind of really angry and stressed, you'd be in the left quadrant. This is just kind of like sad, dull, bored down here, and this is just calm, relaxed, serene down here. So we have users kind of tell us what they're feeling. People can't do that right away very well because we aren't used to thinking about our own emotions. So it takes like 3 days before you get really good. Like I always put my circle here the first 3 days, and then I realize, oh, you know what, I'm not always super happy and aroused. And so sometimes we throw away the first couple of days when we do longitudinal studies, but eventually you start to see people moving it around quite a bit. We also used to ask things like, how engaged are you with your current task? So that was one way that Gloria and I, for instance, in our research were able to show that people were super interested in the work they were doing if they were working hard or not. So Gloria and I have really wanted to try to capture what's going on in the workplace as well as possible. So all our studies were done in situ with real people doing their real work. And then as you can imagine from what I was just talking about in terms of sensing, we log the heck out of them. So we do make them wear heart rate monitors, or we made them wear sense cams, or we made them wear EDA bracelets. We bother them all the time asking them, how stressed are they? You know, what are they feeling? Are they engaged in their work? We have them fill out questionnaires in the morning, questionnaires in the evening. We really log them. And the goal was to see if we could somehow learn how to improve productivity and happiness and reduce stress at work, because you know that would be kind of the holy grail. And as I say, we look at multitasking and interruptions in particular in the real workplace. And you know, today we have so many ways that we can self-interrupt ourselves. I call it self-stimulating. I'm self-stimming right now. Get out of my office. And so you know, you can go Snapchat, Facebook, YouTube, and we've done some earlier work showing, in fact, that you leave work at the end of the day happier when you go to Facebook more often. So these companies that shut off social media are shooting themselves in the foot. And we think that this is a natural thing because people need to take what we call micro breaks or short periods of time. You can't stay 150% focused all the time, right? That's just impossible. You have a rhythm, which I'll show you in a minute. The typical study, this was one of our recent ones we just ran, but they're all kind of the same. Is we have people fill out all these surveys, like I said. We look at their personality type, etc. Then we slap some sensors on them. We log them like crazy so we know like what windows they're in, what apps they're using, how often they're switching. We try to do it for a couple weeks minimum. We've done as long as 4 weeks, but we try to do a couple weeks minimum. And then they fill out these questionnaires at the beginning and at the end of the day, telling us did they accomplish what they meant to accomplish during the day and how productive do they feel, etc., etc. And what we tend to find in these kinds of studies is things like the rhythm of work, for instance. So there's this kind of interesting rhythm. You come in the morning, and it depends on when you start your day, of course, but you start out and you just do crappy email, trying to get the busy work out of the way, right? You read your New York Times, whatever it is you do, and then you ramp up and you're really getting to work. This big black line is when they were focused. And this is pretty typical, we see this in every study. You get really focused by 10 or 11, you're really cranking along, and then you know you go to lunch, you see a dip in focus, and then they come back to their desks or wherever they're working, and they start doing crappy email again, and all the crappy stuff that happened while they were at lunch, and then they ramp back up again, and are really pumping away by 3 o'clock, and then it ramps down into the evening. And this is pretty typical. And you know, we look at things like email and when they were bored and when they were in Facebook. Luckily, these were Microsoft employees. Luckily, they're on Facebook all day long. And how often they use mail and what that does to their stress levels and productivity levels. So that's kind of a typical finding. I hope I have it in here. Yes, okay. So after 5 years of doing these kinds of studies, what have we found? And I think I should just cut to the quick and tell you what we're working on now. What we want to do is build tools that allow people to focus. And we had a hackathon last summer where we built this thing called Flow. Gloria and I kind of simulated that in order to test the idea of Flow. So this was a software that basically, we had people just do their normal work for a week, and we did cortisol samples at the end of that first week. To measure their stress, so they had to spit for us. And then we had them work for a full week where they had to use our Flow software, which basically they told us which were black sites that they had to blacklist. So anything that was non-work related, like Facebook, like Snapchat, like YouTube, all those things, they were shut out of that with the software. So, but they were the ones who told us which these blacklisted sites were, right? And then they were allowed to go into their work-related productivity sites and websites. We made them do this for 8 hours. So when they came in, they were supposed to turn on the software, be in this Flow situation. They couldn't even use their phone, right, for email and stuff like that. So they couldn't tweet, stuff like that. And then at the end of the day, they came out of it, right? And how did that make them feel? And I won't show any slides or anything because we're still writing the paper actually right now as we speak. But I can tell you that two things happened. There's a group of people who were very unable to control themselves. So the story becomes something about control. So if you lack self-control and you don't realize how often you're going into social media and whatnot and interrupting your work, you benefited from this tool quite a bit. But if you are someone who's actually very good at kind of scheduling when you do productivity work and when you take a break, it drove you crazy because that second half that I was talking about, they actually just kept working and kept working and kept working. At the end of the day, they were more stressed in our software because they couldn't get out. They couldn't go do anything to take a break. And some people did do like physical work breaks, which was good, and we're actually still gonna analyze that data. But a lot of the people that were really in good control of their use of social media, whatnot, they just worked harder. And so that's not good. So now we know you want to make this software so that maybe it's for 30-minute chunks of time or something like that. Maybe the user designates how long you go into the flow state and when you come out. So it could be that we use machine learning to kind of adapt to your rhythm of work and your flow. But I think it's really cool, and I think we'll probably do something at Microsoft around this 5-year work effort where we've learned so much. Yeah, so that's basically saying this, that we should actually do person-specific models of how you like to work and when you need a break. And it could be really good for the consumer, but it could also be really good for Microsoft in terms of evaluating products if we actually are doing personalized models of how you're using software, how you're being productive. Maybe we see things about our software design that aren't good and are making you frustrated and stressed, and then we could adapt better. So that's kind of the end of that. Any questions on productivity at work and stress? Okay. So the first real effective system we built, where we had like camera and we were listening to you and looking at your face and looking at your calendar, was called Affect Aura. And I'm not actually going to do a demo or anything. This is what the user interface looked like. It wasn't the best looking user interface, but the idea here was it showed you hour by hour how active you were being, what windows and applications you had open, and how you felt, who you were with at the time, where you were according to GPS. And you could kind of flip through time and see what made you happy and sad. And as a psychologist, I know very well that there's this von Restorff effect, and when something really big happens and really important, you remember it really well. So we weren't trying to capture that. What we were trying to show you for self-reflection was these micro patterns of badness. So people would look back over their last week and say, oh gosh, I didn't even remember Monday was that bad, you know. And oh God, look, I got that email from this person. I always feel bad when I get an email from that person, usually their boss. And so they said, you know, I could make decisions by looking at this if I had it over a year of maybe I'm not going to go to that meeting anymore because it just makes me super unhappy to hang out with that group, or that project isn't going anywhere and I'm always feeling miserable. So people said they really wanted it, but they wanted it in real time. So when we built Affector, you actually went back and looked at your data after it had been processed. They said, no, this would be really important to have in real time. So we went on a mission to do that. And the first way we did that, we thought, well, the group that would benefit from this the most might be doctors. So we had the director of oncology at Seattle Cancer Care and UW come to us, and he said, oh my God, so the data shows that the longer a doctor, an oncologist works, like let's say this oncologist has 20 years of training, the worse bedside manner they get. So that's what the data has shown. And that's because, you know, it's a really tough job. You're telling people this bad news every single day and you try to protect yourself, right? So we thought, wow. We looked at the literature. It said, you know, that those doctors speak too fast, they speak too loud, they don't listen to the patient, they're domineering, et cetera, et cetera. But they're the good ones, right? They've got 20 years of training. So we thought, how can we fix this situation? So we came up with a visualization based on some honest signals research we'd done, which looks at the face and looks at how you speak, not what you say, but how you say it. And we were giving feedback to people in video conferencing. We took that work that we were doing and applied it to how a doctor is interacting with a patient. And what we would do is over the patient, we would show the doctor some cues about how warm they're being and how domineering they're being. So it was a little teeter-totter that tottered towards the doctor if the doctor was doing all the talking and not listening to the patient, and a sun that was getting really warm if the doctor was being warm, or it got really little if the doctor was being very cold, right? We did a study of the system, and we had 16 medical professionals come in, and they actually said, you know, I can look at it, but I'm worried, because it's multidimensional, I'm worried it's going to take attention away from my patient. So could you please redesign it so that it's not, you know, I don't have to look at two things and try to figure it out. So we did. We went back to the drawing board, and I'll show you a video, hopefully it's going to work, of where the design went. Hopefully it's loud enough.
Clinicians' nonverbal communication skills can make a big difference to patients. Our Entendre system records the interactions of patients and clinicians and provides visual feedback for clinicians. Clinicians can choose to adjust their nonverbal cues in response to the feedback, which could result in patients feeling less anxious, trusting their clinicians more, and potentially having better treatment results. How does Entendre work? Nonverbal cues are picked up from live audio and video streams. Nonverbal cue sequences from the video are assigned relative weights of control and affiliation. Control and affiliation are core dimensions of interpersonal communication. The control dimension ranges from submissive to dominant, while the affiliation dimension ranges from hostile to friendly. We are currently exploring different visual feedback designs that display levels of control and affiliation. One feedback idea comes in the form of a lotus flower. As a new pair of petals forms, the petal size adjusts in real time based on the individual's level of conversational control. The petal color also changes depending on the affiliation of the individual. Here, the petals change from a cool blue to a neutral gray to a warm orange as the clinician's affiliation level increases. Each pair of petals reveals information about nonverbal signals during 1 minute of conversation, and the entire flower represents the last 5 minutes of conversation. We are further examining the use of Entendre with clinicians and patients in an actual clinical setting with various designs.
Okay, so that was Entendre. And we did actually get to the point where we were recording the oncologists with their patients in actual one-on-one meetings. Actually, it was usually one-on-two, because it usually was the oncologist with a patient and a caretaker. And we could get all their signals, and we were training the machine learning models, and our IRB ran out. This is probably a story many of you are familiar with. And we didn't keep going. It's really sad. So it's never come to life. But I have a colleague, Rafa Calvo, who is trying to build a similar system, and we're collaborating with him, so hopefully. I think it'd be great for training doctors. I don't think it'd necessarily be so useful in the office, although we did bring the same 16 healthcare workers back that looked at the first visualization, and we had them look at the new visualization while they watched a video of themselves, and we moved it around with the Wizard of Oz technique so they'd see how the lotus flower would change. And all but one doctor said that they would use it in a professional setting. The one doctor told us that she was already had a great bedside manner. She didn't need it. One doctor said that we should put it on the face of the clock because they have to look at the clock all the time anyway, and that wouldn't be seen as disruptive. So interesting ideas. They all seemed pretty positive about it, so we'll see. Okay, the next one I'm going to talk about is Parent Guardian. This was actually with Laura Pena, as you know. And what Laura had found, she had done some interviewing with families of ADHD children, and what she had found was that all the parents of these kids are given handbooks about how to model good behavior when there's a meltdown with the child. But what they told Laura was that in the heat of the moment, they throw that out the window. And it's already too late by the time, you know, they start trying to think of what they should do. And everybody loses their temper. So we decided we wanted to use some of the sensors we were working with to do just-in-time interventions for the parents, and I'll explain what I mean by that. So in this case, we had 16 Microsoft families. Turns out in the greater Puget Sound area, and probably down here as well, it's really easy to find families with autistic and ADHD kids because there's a lot of tech families. In this case, it was 16 fathers that worked at Microsoft that all also had ADHD, had kids with ADHD. So it was easy to recruit them. And what we decided to do was we built an app, a phone app, and put displays in their house where they tended to hang out at night. And the phone app was just a simple app that we took from the handbook that these parents were given for how to model good behavior when there's a parenting instance. And we just made them into kind of cartoony, really easy to visualize and learn interventions. So this one says something about chilling out. It's a polar bear. And on the phone, the parent reads what they're supposed to do, because there's text. But in the actual environment, in the house where the kid is, we would never show the text. We'd just show the cue, the mnemonic cue, which was usually a cartoon kind of picture. But the parents, the first week, they learned these interventions. There were 20 of them on the phone using the app. And there were no sensors. They just learned it in their free time. And we knew they were using it because we were monitoring them. And then the second week, we slapped EDA bracelets on the mom because the dads weren't really part of the study. And what we did was we detected their EDA arousal. So when their skin got really sweaty, we knew that there was an arousal event. We didn't know what the valence was. We didn't know if it was a good thing that they were getting aroused or a very upsetting thing if they were getting aroused. But that's what we used to then, the second week, send an intervention. So we would just randomly pick an intervention that they'd learned from the 20, and we'd send it to their phones, and we'd send it to the display in the environment. So even if they didn't have their phone with them, you know, they'd see something on the wall and they would remember to act. This was a great population to work with. I don't know if any of you have worked with parents of children like this before. I know Jillian has. They were extremely motivated to use the technology. They said things like, when you got it right, notice I said when you got it right, and we'll talk about that in a minute. When you got it right, they said it was the most empowering thing in the world. And what would happen is they'd hear their phone buzz, even if it was like on the table and they weren't there. They'd hear the phone buzz, and they wouldn't look at the display per se. They'd actually just think of the intervention that they liked the best, and they'd do it. And they said, oh my God, that was so empowering. So it was good that they memorized them that first week. So why did I say when you get it right? So we don't know the valence that's driving the EDA arousal event, right? So sometimes they got intervention notices when things were happy, when they were elated, et cetera. But the thing was, this group totally knew that the technology was going to have near misses and false starts. And they said, you know, I just ignored it. I knew there was nothing wrong, and I just ignored it. So that was the great thing about this group, is they were super motivated. They didn't care about failure and used the technology. So my favorite story about this work is that Laura left, and you know, the study was finished. We took the EDA bracelets back from all the families. 2 years later, I was giving a talk to my VP's VP's VP or something like that, and I went back into the database to do the slides, and the parents, half of the families were still using the app. So that tells you something right there. I think that's the best data. Okay, I had one of Tanzeem Chowdhury's students, Rufat, who just took a job at UMass Amherst, actually, yesterday. And he's great. He's a sensor guy, and he was totally into the fact that we were making all these wearables and everything. And I think he felt like he was a little, maybe he had an eating problem or something like that. He really wanted to detect about-to-eat moments. We had done some work on that with a bra with built-in sensors, trying to detect when women were going to eat, make bad eating decisions because of stress. So he wanted to do a similar thing. And so he built this real, well, let me set it up first. You know, he did all this research showing obesity is one of the leading causes of preventable death. I don't have to tell people in the room here that. And people have all these different ways of tracking what they eat. How many people in here have tried logging food? And how many people are still doing it? So nobody. Oh, you're still doing it. That's amazing. Most people don't. So you have my Fitness Pal and all these wearable devices. And people work out really hard trying to, you know, equalize their caloric intake and their caloric outtake. But, you know, the research shows that most people abandon. We did our own little MTurk study, and it shows that most people abandon the use of these food logging tools within days, if not months, for sure. And there's a real low level of compliance regardless across all the forms that you can do this in. And what we did in the survey that I liked was we asked people, well, if you did have something that automatically tracked when you were eating and it was going to send an intervention to you to remind you to make good eating decisions, when would you want that intervention? And it turns out there were some like real key times when people wanted a system to remind them to eat healthy. So that was good, because that gave us a target. And he did this research where it showed that once you serve yourself food on a plate, you're going to eat 92% of it. So that's why he reminds you to eat with a smaller plate. So this is what he built. It's so funny. So it's called Chewy. These are all the components. It worked with your smartphone. There was this little microphone that he had to have on your throat because he was detecting mastication events. So he could tell not only when you were chewing, but what you were chewing. and kind of like what its texture was. But he also had all these other things, GPS, gyroscope, everything. So it turns out, actually, he started tracking himself and a few other people. They were walking around all the time wearing this thing. I think he's permanently disabled now. But he could predict all kinds of bodily functions, and I'll just leave it at that. So instead of calling it Chewy for a while, we called it Pooey. but he got very good at being able to detect when you were about to eat. And so to run a study with that, he actually had to write an app where you would self-report where you were and when you were about to eat. So you had to say, I'm starting to eat now, I'm finishing now. He wanted you to enter something about your mood, so you had to pick a picture of moods. And then he asked a couple other questions here about how you were feeling, and do you feel worse now that you ate, or was it healthy, et cetera, et cetera. And then, after a few weeks with about five people, he did machine learning on it and got quite good and actually had a Best Paper Award for this work. So adherence to the food logging techniques is low, but it is possible to predict when people are about to eat. And this would allow us to trigger these just-in-time interventions like we did for the parents of ADHD children. I don't know, because we haven't actually deployed it, if people would find it annoying or not, I can imagine. Because his internship ended right when we finished the machine learning models. We didn't actually do the intervention part. But he assures me we're going to get there now that he's got his job and he's finished with his dissertation. What I really like about this work, and I think the reason I got a Best Paper Award, is because predicting about to do X moments is really generalizable if you think about it, right? If we could predict when you were about to smoke or when you were about to take a drink and you're trying seriously to stop those behaviors, technology could be super useful to target in and help you, especially when you couple it with things like GPS and whatnot. There's a lot we could do with the technology. And Ronnie, my colleague in crime in machine learning, is very, very excited to use this for targeting precision psychology. That's what he calls it. So really being able to target when a seriously mentally ill person is close to hurting themselves or something like that. So we've got a lot of work to do to move forward in that area, but that's the next thing for this research. Okay, now for something completely different. How many people know about the power pose in that research? Okay. Well, if you don't know about it, I think I have a picture here. Let me skip to it. This is the power pose, and that's the power pose author right there, which it's come under all kinds of consternation, and it's kind of in ill repute now. But I'm still going to talk about it because whether or not the power pose, I was supposed to tell you what it is, sorry. Supposedly if you stand here like this for like 2 minutes or 3 minutes, you are a much more confident speaker, okay? Or if you there are many power poses, you could do this, I guess, I don't know. But it's supposed to be some powerful stance, and then all of a sudden, you've got all this self-confidence. Well, Gene came to my lab, and he was inspired. I talked about the honest signals work we did to show doctors how warm or non-warm they were being, et cetera. Well, there are all kinds of honest signals. And Gene said, I wonder if the power pose works or doesn't. I wonder if there are other things we can do automatically to the user that would make them feel more powerful or more confident. And I was kind of skeptical when he started talking about this. Then he had the idea of, oh, we could do something to the way you sound. Maybe that's going to be more important than the way you stand, right? So the way you sound to yourself. So he started playing around with that. And in the research, it shows that low-pitched voices actually are associated with dominance. The literature, I did read the same papers he read. The literature is a little bit all over the place. It wasn't completely clear. But the one thing that seemed to be clear was decreases in pitch seem to be make you sound more powerful to yourself. And so we came up with an idea of just playing back your own voice to you 5% lower pitch, okay? And I thought that this was really great. So we made up the cover story was, we're in research, we're testing out these new headphones, okay? And this was the most fun experiment, you guys. So we brought in people from the Pacific Northwest, this wasn't hard to do at all, who were extremely liberal. And this was around the time of the election, in fact it was election time. And we recorded one of our colleagues, Stephen Drucker's voice, reading some very, very violently right-wing, conservative debate content from debate.com. But it was the kind of violent, angry banter that would make you very angry, right, if you heard it. Most of you, if you heard it, you would be very upset. And we chose topics about immigration to the US from Syria, whether or not homosexuals should be allowed to get married, and there was one other one that I'm forgetting now, but they were all very controversial subjects. And what they had to do was they heard Stephen Drucker angrily reading this content that was obviously against their beliefs. They had 5 minutes to write down. They thought he was in another room, but it was just a recording. Then they had to collect their thoughts and they had to debate. Then they heard him again and they had to debate again. And there were, I think I have the conditions in how we did this study. Yeah, so there were three conditions. The low pitch, where the participants heard their own voices with a lower pitch, so it's supposed to make them feel more confident to themselves. And this was in pretty much real time. There was like a 100-millisecond delay, but you couldn't tell, and it almost seemed like, if you did notice it, very few people did, but if you did notice it, it almost seemed like the headphones weren't very good. So we knew when people heard the delay because they would say, oh, those headphones weren't very good. And then the control was the participant heard their voice with the normal pitch. Then we also had a third condition where we actually raised the pitch of the other voice, hoping that it would make them seem less confident when they were reading the debate, so you still felt more powerful. That manipulation did not work. But this one, okay, here's what the experimental design looked like. So in between these horrible debates that these people had to go through, they got to see a tranquil, meditative for 5 minutes, and then they would get back in the debate again. It was exhausting. They took it super seriously, so just so you know, they took it super seriously and really, you know, they really debated. The videos are hilarious because it's funny when you look at people's faces when they're angry, they actually smile because they're just so disgusted with the other person that they're debating with. So we got some great emotional video and audio. And these were our measures. So we were really looking at perceptions of power because we wanted the user to feel more powerful in a conflict situation. And that was our whole motivation. I should have started out with this. Our whole motivation was there are very few ways to teach conflict resolution to people. So at Microsoft, the way you get taught about how to handle conflict as a leader in the company, you actually have a VP screaming in your face in a simulation. They're spitting at you. And they have to see how you handle that. And it's horrible training. So we were thinking, you know, oh, if we could just give people tools that are like everyday tools that they could just wear like a video conferencing headphone or something like that, and train them that way, that could be really great. So we did have a bunch of measures. We looked at their speech behavior, their patterns, not what they said, their ratings of power, and then we had a heart rate monitor on them, and we also did the positive and negative affect scale, so we could see what that was like when they came out. And we actually did get some really nice behavioral results. So in terms of feelings of power, their ratings, the low pitch condition was significantly higher than the other two. That's just this finding here. We also had your behavioral change. So this is just some measures of energy and noise ratios and pauses. In all ways, you spoke more confidently. We did not find a gender effect. We actually thought that it would have a bigger effect on females than on males, but it didn't. It helped everybody. And also your HRV, higher is better. And it was significantly higher in the low pitch condition than in the other two. So even their physiological signals of stress were reduced by hearing their own voice back lower pitch. So I was skeptical, but it actually did work. And something as simple as just hearing yourself sound more confident can really change your behavior. So Gene is still working in this area, and he's probably going to do amazing things. Okay. Just last little bit here on the affective side, or on the app side, I should say. We've done a couple of apps now that are getting a little more serious. The first one was called Pop Therapy, and that was actually made for the general population, and it gave you about 16 different categories of ways of trying to incorporate mindfulness and good stress-relieving behaviors into your daily life. We did a 4-week study with 100 people, It turns out that if you want people to use your app for a long, long period of time, get neurotic people, because the only people who finished the whole 4 weeks were personality neurotic. The people we really, really, really wanted to help, the really stressed out ones, were the ones who dropped out in the first 2 weeks, unfortunately. So we know that the design wasn't perfect. One of the things that happened was we used machine learning to send interventions to people based on what they said they liked early in the study. And what happened is we didn't have enough interventions. So once we figured out what kind of interventions you wanted, it kept giving you the same ones all the time, and it got boring. So people told us that at the end. But for the people that did use it all 4 weeks, by the end of the study, they were using more positive coping behaviors and using fewer negative coping behaviors for stress. So it actually did have a good effect, but we learned the hard way that you have to have a lot of variety in these apps. So we've moved on. Now we're doing something called, I have another picture of it here. Let me see if I have a better. Now we're doing something called pocket skills. This is Dr. Marsha Linehan. How many people know what dialectical behavior therapy is? Okay, not too many. It's a form of therapy that Marsha invented. She actually suffers from bipolar disorder and was suicidal herself. And she learned techniques throughout her career to make herself better. And she published it. And now it's the number one world leading prevention for suicide therapy that's out there. So she came to us. She said the funniest thing. She goes, Mary, she goes, you know how you feel about the Seahawks? And I go, yeah, I love the Seahawks. And she goes, that's how I feel about Microsoft. And I was like, what? Who says that anymore? And she was like, no, I only use Microsoft products. So she was a big Microsoft fan, so she came to me and asked me if I would ship her content to the world for free. And we said, sure, we'll do it. You know, you're the expert, you tell us what to do. So we got her PhD student to come, and basically we put all of DBT into an app. And we are right now studying it. We've had 13 suicidal people do a usability study for us for 2 weeks. We found a lot of navigation problems. We found some things they didn't like. We fixed them. We're now getting ready to do a random controlled trial with it, with the new content and whatnot. And Marsha's thrilled. I'm going to meet with her next week, actually. It's the first time she'll see the whole app, like all fixed and polished. And the idea is really, we've gamified it a little bit. Turns out you can do a conversational UI when the person's very famous. They all know who she is, and so they feel like they're in therapy with her. We have a lot of videos of her, and she's got a very unique presentation style. So it turns out a conversational UI is really, really good for this population because they feel like they're talking to Marsha. So there's a lot of this app where they just type in things free form, and then you can use machine learning to try to customize the kinds of skills Marsha teaches them in therapy and whatnot. And it's a great complement to your DBT therapy sessions that you might do once a week, et cetera. So we're still testing it, but it shows great promise, and we're really excited about it. Okay, we're moving on. Why? Okay. Oh, okay. That's all I just said. But one of the things that we have learned is that a lot of the stuff that's really important in conversational UIs, in terms of, luckily it's Marsha, and they all know who Marsha is, so that works really well. If you don't have a known celebrity that you can use in your conversational UI, other things become really important, and that's what we'll talk about next with Cortana. Oh, but I just wanted to show you that the DBT app really did work, because by the end of 2 weeks, they were saying they had less fear, they had more joy in their lives, less anger. So that was really great. Even though it was really just a usability study, we still wanted to track and get a little data, and it was great. The other thing we learned, and I didn't say this, is that for every category of intervention you give somebody psychologically or to handle stress, there's somebody who really likes that category of intervention, and there's somebody who really hates it. So you really have to use machine learning to figure out what kind of person likes what under what circumstances, and then have a lot of variety. Because once you start winnowing it down to the thing that works for that person, they don't want to get the same kind of advice every time they use the app. So that's something that we learned. But we did also learn that, you know, you can tell people that they're stressed, and that does stress them out. And that's something you really have to be careful of when you do this kind of research, right? But we did teach them simple ways to handle their stress, and that was really good. So, you know, there's always the people that just don't want help. All right, last last topic. I said we were working with the Cortana team, and we are. We were asked by the product folks, like, okay, what's going to convince people to tell their personal information to Cortana? Like, why would anyone ever do that? The more Cortana knows about you, or any personal assistant, the better personal assistant it can be, she can be. But until you get people to trust it, they're gonna wonder why Microsoft wants that information about them, right? So we looked into trust. That was like the first thing we did. Turns out, I'm actually doing a lit review on this right now, the evidence is overwhelming. We all like agents that are like us, right? So you want an agent that matches your personality style. You want an agent that's beautiful, because you're, of course, beautiful. You want an agent that talks like you. So I'll show you some results from that in a second. But that's an overwhelming fact of life. So the first thing we looked at was physical attractiveness, because we thought that was going to be the easiest to kind of control. The literature told us that people tend to attribute traits to attractive people that they possibly don't have. So, for instance, it's very well known that attractive people move up higher in the organizations. They make more money. They think they're more intelligent. I think I have, here's another one. Justice is not blind, so unattractive defendants get longer sentences. Attractive defendants are less likely to be convicted. So all of this is real life, right? This is just the way it is. So we decided to do a very simple study. Ignore the three condition up here, because it really just didn't work. We had agents that were highly accurate or not so accurate. And we had agents that were attractive or agents that were just neutral. And I'll show you what those pictures look like in a minute. And so just think of it, this is a 2x2. And we had some hypotheses. The first one is that users will trust a more accurate agent, regardless of attractiveness. That's what you'd kind of think, right? Accuracy is the most important thing. And hypothesis two is that users will trust a more attractive agent, regardless of accuracy. So who thinks hypothesis one is right? Just take a show of hands. Who thinks hypothesis two is right? Okay. So these were our agents. And these were just images of an agent. This was not an embodied agent that, you know, moved around or anything. I think Vesta Uxel, who did this work, I think she found these images from a group in the UK who had somehow amalgamated like thousands and thousands and thousands of images of people and came up with the ultimate attractive face. And so our users were able to pick whether they wanted a male or a female. And then they were told they were going to get various agents at various times in their tasks, and they could use the agent to get the answer to their task or not. So this is what they were doing. We were asking them pretty hard questions. This one's kind of an easy one. Most of them were really hard. You had to actually go out to the web to try to find the answer. They would be doing this, and they were on a timer. And sometimes an agent would pop up, and you could choose to use it, and sometimes it was super inaccurate, and sometimes it was accurate, sometimes it was ugly or neutral, and sometimes it was very attractive, okay? So what do we find? Well, attractiveness trumps accuracy, unfortunately. So all of you that raised your hand for hypothesis two were right. So this is the low reliable, highly attractive agent. It's very intelligent, it's very accurate, right? And here's the highly reliable neutral agent, not so much, right? So, and people did click on them equally often. The conditions were short enough that they didn't really notice a pattern in accuracy, so they clicked on the agents a lot. So that was disheartening, but now we know that if we design an agent, we really need it to be attractive. And then we looked at linguistic style. How many have read Men Are From Mars, Women Are From Venus? That's Deborah Tannen's work. She has another theory, this theory about conversational style. And it's kind of simplistic, but I think there might be something to it. So if you're an HI person, I think I have the definitions here. HI person, you're a high involvement speaker. It means that when you're talking in a group, you don't mind that multiple people are talking at once and they're taking very few pauses and you don't have a lot of variety in your voice. And there's a lot of enthusiasm. Sorry, you have a lot of variety in your voice. There's a lot of pitch variation and whatnot. If you're an HC person, you kind of think, I really don't like it when people talk over me. I really like it to look like people stop and listen to what I'm saying before they respond. It's a much more consistent prosody, and they just don't like interruption. So we had to do a Mechanical Turk study, so what we did was we had to have, there is no survey tool or instrument for determining if someone is HI or HC, unfortunately, in the literature. So we had to make one up ourselves. So we basically had people tell us their speaking style, and then we asked them questions around this HI and HC-ness, like, do you like it when people talk over you? You know, why or why not? Do you like it when multiple people are talking at the same time? Do you like it when people wait and think before they respond, et cetera? And then we classified them into HI or HC. And so we did a big study on the Mechanical Turk, and we counterbalanced by random assignment. It was all within subjects. So we had people kind of converse with this agent. I don't know if I have a screen that shows what it was like. No, I don't, unfortunately. So basically, there was an agent. It was a text agent. It was a conversation agent. And it was recorded? Yes, it was recorded. So we knew the user was supposed to read something on the screen that we gave them. It was to simulate a conversation. We knew when they were done talking because we were listening. And as soon as they were done talking, actually, even before they were done talking, if it was in the HC condition, I mean in the HI condition, because we made the agent talk over them and talk really faster, da 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 da. And in the HC condition, the agent would wait politely, a second would go by, and then the agent would talk. So they just basically had a back and forth conversation with this agent. And we wanted to know, you know, will users be able to differentiate between these agents' styles? And will they like an agent that matches their style, basically? That was the research question. And in fact, that's what we found. So did you like the agent when it was matched? You liked the agent more than when it was not matched. Would you continue interacting with that agent? It was higher if you were matched. Did you think it was engaging? Higher. Did you trust it more, which is what we're after in a lot of these studies? Yes, they trusted it more. So kind of a simple manipulation for a conversational agent that, you know, all we would have to do is listen to a user for a little while, and we would be able to determine what kind of style they are, and then we could match it. And I love the user's comments around this. If you just take a minute to read one or two of them, it's like, you know, much better, because the speech pattern was slower and more realistic. More relaxed. I preferred the second one. She waited for me. Or here, this seems like a real voice because it was bouncier and it was indicative of human interaction, right? And the first one sounded robotic. This was all within subjects, so everybody had both kinds of agent. So I find that a really useful and interesting manipulation for how to interact with humans in a conversation you want. So what have we learned? Well, we can measure affect, and we can use it to build tools for productivity and well-being, but also, and increasingly more, I'm trying to get Microsoft to start using affect detection to actually build products. We've already done it in the usability labs and user studies where we wire people up. Now we can just do it with camera and audio recording. I think it should be built into every product. And my catchphrase for this is, how do you know you're designing products that delight people if you don't know if people are delighted? Right? And you could iterate on this, right? You could first show where the parts of the user interface are super frustrating, fix those, and then you should be able to see affect goes up, right? But I think it should be built into all software, all technology from the ground up. And I'd mentioned the flow tools that Gloria and I worked on. I really actually think we're going to ship something like this someday soon. We actually now know that simple affect measurements of teams predict team performance, and this is a new research area direction I'm going in. There are all kinds of ways you can do it. I just found out at CSCW a few weeks ago, so I'm very excited about that. And we've learned that with these apps that we've been doing to try to teach people stress tools and productivity tools, we've learned that people like stress interventions to be social or physical and brief. Easy to do. They'll do them if it's just get up and do a stretch. They'll do it. They actually welcome it. If it's going and grabbing a neighbor for a cup of coffee, they'll go take a walk. They actually welcome those kinds of suggestions. They don't actually like the pure psychological ones. that are actually hard to do. That's interesting. So we found you have to make these interventions a little bit more accessible to real people, at, you know, who don't have a therapist, for instance, and make them fun and easy. And then, of course, I finished with the fact that conversational agents that reflect our own style or are beautiful are the kind we trust and want to interact with more. That's it. Thank you. Questions? Yes.
Thanks. This is really interesting work.
I'm wondering,
with the last stuff you were talking about with the agents.
Yeah.
And you mentioned that you let people choose the gender of the agent. Did you test for gender effects?
We didn't get any gender effects whether you used the guy or the gal.
Okay. But you didn't have people actually try both and compare trustworthiness.
No, we did not. They just picked the gender that they wanted. Okay. We wanted them to self-identify with the agent somewhat. I think that was Best's idea. That could be looked at.
I'm curious, as well, with the conversational style with the interactions and that kind of stuff.
Yes. It would be very good to like have people pick one and see how that works. It's really hard on Mechanical Turk. I don't know how many of you use Mechanical Turk. It's really hard to get like a multi-turn conversation on Mechanical Turk. You have to fabricate it. We tried to see if people would start to mimic an agent's style in a 17 turn taking experiment. And because the only way you can get a 17 turn taking thing is to ask stupid, like, where are you from kinds of questions, et cetera, it was really hard to get the effect. We got a small effect showing that, if an agent has a particular style, you might start to mimic it. But we haven't really done a good study of that. But good question. Yes.
A really great talk.
Thank you.
Thing that really interests me is that most of these studies are based on self-reporting. Do you think that self-reporting may be an issue at some stage, like people may not be aware of what they are thinking or how they are feeling? So how does these kind of things are taken into consideration?
Yeah, I think, I don't know if you were here at the very beginning, but what I said is a lot of people they're not used to thinking about their own emotional state.
Yeah.
So it takes a little while before they get good at it.
Yeah.
So you definitely have to take that into account. So maybe wait a few days and let them learn how their emotions vary throughout the day.
Mm-hmm.
Then they can get better. We have looked at associations of the self-reports to physiological measures. They're usually in the right direction, not always, not for everybody, but they're usually in the right direction. So that makes me feel a little more confident about the self-reporting. But if you talk to somebody like Jeremy Pennebaker, who does the Luke analysis, I don't know if any of you know what that is, but he looks at your pronouns and whatnot in the text you write.
Yeah.
And he claims that's the only true way to get real effective measures, implicitly, not explicitly by asking people. So he feels very strongly about that and argues with me about it all the time. So it's entirely possible that people aren't very good at it. We have had two male participants in all these years who just refused to believe that a machine could know their affect better than they do. And the funny thing is they were both wearing sensors when they had this argument, and their arousal was going up and up and up and up. The angrier they got. And the poor intern was saying, look at the signal. And he's like, no machine can know better than I know myself, kind of thing. So there are people that are very skeptical of that, and you know, we had started playing with the idea of wearing your affect on your sleeve, literally. So we were building wearables that, you know, when you got angry, you had hackles in your back. Or when you're happy, it like laughed. And 50% of the people right off the bat were like, no way. Yeah, I spend half my time hiding my emotions. The last thing I'm going to do is wear that, you know. But we did do one display that it was a crystal and you just put it on your desk. And you could cover it up if you wanted to. And we deployed that with 10 of our admins upstairs on the fourth floor. And they loved it for each other. So when they came into each other's office and they saw that you were stressed, they would help you. If they saw you were bored, they'd give you work from their pile. And when a manager came in, boom, right? So for your own peer circle, you may be okay showing some emotional signal if it benefited you somehow. But yeah. There was something, yes, back there.
So I was curious for the conversational styles in that last study. You mentioned that there weren't really scales you guys kind of develop one. So I was curious, were you able to kind of confirm the theory of those two? Did they seem pretty reliable? And what were I'm just curious, what was the distribution of people in one style versus the other?
You know, it was well balanced. And I don't know, we actually had trouble getting into CHI with that paper because we had never validated that scale before, but there wasn't anything else out there, so we had to rely on that. I would love to actually do another study just for the purpose of validating that scale. I do think that it might be a moot point because, and this is why I haven't done that, because if we can listen to your voice in the way you prefer to talk, that's the best. We don't have to categorize you. We just need to mimic it, right? So in a way, it's kind of a moot point. We just want an agent to mimic your voice, and then we're done. So, but it did cause us trouble. We had a little bit of trouble publishing the first round with that, just because of that. Good question.
Okay. Well, I would like to invite everybody to come downstairs for the social hour, and I would especially like people to talk with Mary, ask questions. Maybe you're too shy to talk in front of everyone, but please, Mary is happy to speak with you. So downstairs, special hour. Thanks again. Thank you.